Okay, so this is development. You see? So we've got our three big sections, exposition, which we talked about, which is traditionally repeated. So right after the repeat sign, you get the development. Incidentally, in Mozart's time, you'll see in that K332 and in this K333, actually a repeat sign after the development, and you'd have a recap, and Mozart would put the repeat here at the end, which kind of demonstrates that sonata form evolves from Baroque binary form, where the exposition constitutes the A section that modulated from one to the dominant, right? If that makes sense. And then the development recap brings us back to the tonic, and the recap then is what makes it sort of a round, large, rounded binary, if that makes sense, and the development is your contrasting, or is the section that gets you, of the B section that gets you back. And in the traditional Baroque binary, each section was repeated, so as sonata form evolved from that, it was customary in Mozart's time to repeat the development recap as well. Over time, particularly at the hands of Beethoven, sonata form begins to grow so large that this is superfluous and actually creates too big of a structure. So this repeat eventually goes away. And in performance today, we see those repeats in Mozart, but we never take them. I don't know anybody that really does do that still. Okay, Reese, did you behave then? Okay. So today we're going to look at the development, which basically does two things. First of all, remember, it has developmental function phrases which are characterized by fragmentation and sequence, right, of ideas that we've heard previously. Also characterized by tonal instability, meaning you'll hear ideas in a variety of keys. And of course, sequencing does that by default. But you'll often hear other themes or such, you know, in keys that we had not heard them in previously. This is where we explore different key relationships. But then the other thing that the development has to do is get us back to tonic. And so at the end of the development, invariably, right, there's a big fat 5-7 chord. Some sort of motion towards 5-7 is necessary. Okay, and we'll look at a few characteristics in this Mozart K333. About that. The other thing I will mention is that the development typically starts with the very first section one theme that we heard, but generally in a different key. So if we have first theme, it might be in the key of the tonic. I'm sorry, the key of the dominant, because we just left the dominant sometimes. Sometimes it's in the minor dominant. Sometimes it's in the minor tonic or the relative minor. Particularly if it's a major key exposition sonata, then the development often starts with a minor key, which can be, like I said, the parallel minor, the dominant minor, which is a little odd. But that makes sense. You're taking the dominant key here, just simply shifting to the parallel minor or the dominant at that point, or going to the relative minor. So that's kind of typical, hearing that first theme again. Then fragmentation and sequence of ideas. And this can be anything. Sometimes you'll even hear a theme or idea of the transition even in fragmentation and sequence. You know, so something that in the exposition kind of had a very, was not very thematic or was didn't seem to have all that much importance can actually be the material that's taken to be fragmented. Sequence. It can be the section 2 melody, it can be the closing theme, it can be the codetta. I mean, any material from the exposition is fair game for development. And you'll see everything developed looking at a variety of sonatas. But then at the end, we got to move to 5-7. And we have to make that move in sort of an important way, because that's what brings back the tonic key at the recap. And of course, this is the moment that sort of closes sonata form this will feel often pretty dramatic, or this is the moment of arrival. We've returned home at this point, and then we're staying in the home key through the remainder. Mm-hmm. Okay, so at least sort of in concept, that's the, what the development does. Let me, on our YouTube video here, shift ahead to the... So here we are with the repeat sign, which we know is the end of the exposition. So does this repeat? Yeah, this goes back, so I gotta get... We have a repeated exposition. Okay, and so now we're ready. Okay, I'll take a video and...
We can share the... Oh, I can't flip it. I'll do it this way. I don't know how well that's going to show up on the video, but hopefully it gives an idea. Yeah, let me do that. Okay. Okay. For those watching at home, this is a little awkward at the moment. Okay, so let me go ahead and start this. So this is coming out of the exposition. Now starting into the development. Okay, so here is our original theme. It's right, a snippet of it in the relative minor. Sorry, not relative minor, the dominant key. Sorry, I know my keys. And then we're getting it in fragmentation sequence. And then here is, trying to remember which, I think that's the closing theme. I'll go back and look. In F minor, right? So not a key we would have heard it previously. And we'll talk about this. This is an interesting way in which, hold on, Reese, in which Mozart treats this sort of shift. And now, into the recap, if that makes sense. Mozart treats this shift into the recap a bit differently than Beethoven tends to. And I did want to talk about that. So let me get back to. Okay, so again, we've ended the exposition in the dominant key in F, and then he's starting this, right, which is our opening theme, but now in the dominant key where we just left. Okay, but it's not, not that he doesn't hear, but, you know, something like, right, yeah. You know, starting in the minor is often something you'll see at the beginning of the development. You can sort of hear what that would potentially sound like. Mm-hmm. But then he takes those ideas. Right. Turns out I can't talk and play at the same time. But we're getting that little snippet of the idea from the theme one, that blum, ba-dum, blum, ba-dum, and getting that in fragmentation and sequence as we would expect. And then this is the closing theme, I think. An idea we've heard previously in the exposition, but now in the key of F minor, which we've not explored. So again, that concept of tonal instability. And then after giving us those ideas, Mozart begins his shift to the dominant, and here he does something kind of surprising. First of all, I do want to point out, let me check my time, we're good. A particular chord, and I'll try to put this on the video, that one would expect. Let's see if I can do this. So if you're following along at home, we've got this harmony here, C sharp, E flat, right? And if you double check the E flat to C sharp interval, it's an augmented sixth.
Okay, and the E flat is resolving down by half step to D. The C sharp is resolving up by half step to D. If you see an augmented sixth interval resolve out to the octave, that is an augmented sixth chord, right? Does that make sense?
Yep.
And which makes this D 5. So if D is 5, the key is G. We've got B flat, E flat, and the key signature still. So this is G minor. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And let me play through that section and let you kind of hear. I'll try to say that. Maybe do that for a little bit.
Let you hear. I'll have to advance the screen. Well, I'll just let the computer or the YouTube. So here is 5 in G minor. And then he's actually somewhere right there. Okay. So playing right there, here we are. Augmented 6 to 5.
Yeah. Mozart's, you know, a little tricky here.
It's kind of a neat progression. He basically is using augmented six chords, ending with the German. He's kind of throwing different flavors of augmented six in there. But the idea is that the augmented six chords are moving to 5, but we're in G minor. The relative minor, not the B flat major that we expect. Something we don't often talk about in music theory, but it's worth knowing. Dominant chords can shift to dominant chords of other keys. You can follow dominant, particularly dominant sevens, with other dominant sevens. I don't know if you've done that in jazz or, but this is an example of that. Where having gotten to 5 in G minor, he immediately shifts abrupt modulation to 5-7 in B flat major. And it turns out, I mean, that sounds okay. So here's our German augmented six. So that is possible. You can go from a dominant chord to another dominant chord to another chord in abrupt modulation. And it actually sounds really quite nice. You know? It does help if you have a common tone. We have a D F sharp A, an F A C E flat, so it's kind of a chromatic modulation. We're holding a common tone and moving the other chord, other notes by step. So the progression sounds very natural. Mm-hmm. But what I hope you begin to realize is what's interesting about the sonata, it's like Mozart ended up in the wrong place. You know, he's done the first theme in F major, we've done some fragmentation in sequence, and then we've had tonal instability introducing the closing theme in a different key. Mm-hmm. And now it's time for the 5-7 to move into the recap, and he ends up on the wrong 5-7 chord. But then he immediately fixes it. You know, it's just kind of like, oh, okay, I know what I'm doing. But a couple points I want to make. The importance of the augmented sixth chord in setting up the 5 chord, even if it's the 5 chord of the wrong key, which in this case it is, but that the augmented sixth chord is the most dissonant and has the strongest demand of resolution to the 5. Does this make sense? But that's why this chord is so important and useful at this moment, because the whole motion to 5-7 is the point at the end of the development. And if the augmented sixth chord moves you there most strongly, then again, and we've mentioned this before, this is where you go hunting for augmented sixth chords. They almost invariably show up at the end of the development. Mm-hmm. The interesting thing here is the augmented sixth chord in the wrong key and ending on the dominant of the wrong key. But then he sort of fixes that just on a whim, which is kind of neat. Then the other thing is that invariably, having made the motion to 5-7 via an augmented sixth chord, the next thing we want to do is create a little bit of tension. And let me stop the video so I don't go over, and we'll pick it up from there.